Well, our next guests are renowned for not only their classic songs, but also for pushing back the boundaries of popular music. Now, they were the first group ever to fuse rock music with a symphony orchestra, and they've also credited, of course, with the concept of the concept album. But they've just released their first album for over, I think it's actually 9 years, and are about to embark on an Easter tour of Britain, including 3 sellout nights at the Royal Albert Hall. But I'm sure they'll always be remembered for writing one of the most beautiful and best-selling songs of all time, Knights in White Satin, which you'll hear at the end of the program. So will you please welcome, from the Moody Blues, Justin Hayward and John Lodge.
Hey. How are you?
Good to see you.
Are you okay?
Yes, I'm good.
Great. Hi, Justin.
Smart as always. Yeah, lovely to see you. You were taking the vitamins to get you ready for that.
Oh, sorry, are you kidding?
I was just saying, as you're walking across, you'll be taking the vitamins, the strength for this tour that you're going to go on.
Absolutely, yeah.
But actually, I was more pleased to hear that the album is out. Is it 9 years or 11? I've heard 2 figures today.
It's been a long time. 92, wasn't it? The last new, a lot of new songs, yeah.
I've heard lots of albums out in between, the different projects and things, but last studio album.
So what about this new material? I mean, how important do you think it is for you at this stage in the game to come up with a new album, new material?
I thought it was really important because we started the album to really be part of the last millennium going into the new millennium, you know, and we really wanted to be part of that. And hence really the title, Strange Times, because everyone was thinking of the Y2K bug and everything else. And here we are, world's still going, and we're all having a great time.
We haven't faded out yet.
No, we haven't.
And in fact, I hear that was the first song that you actually wrote, which became the name of the album.
Yeah, absolutely. People, it's funny, people say, I mean, do you, somebody said to us this morning, do you actually need to make records anymore? Well, I do. We do need to, because we need to make new music, and that's what it's all about, and that's what keeps us going and keeps us together and stops us really being a kind of nostalgia act. And we're lucky enough to have a strong fan base that's always wants new things from us. So
and of course you guys have changed yourselves a lot over the years. So do you find that you write now as to who you are now? You're writing, you know, from your own persona.
Yes, absolutely. You write from your own experience and things that happen to you, and relationships change, and your view on life change. And I think, I mean, I wrote Nights when I was 19 years old, for goodness sake. I mean,
19 years of age.
Yeah, so, but, and, well, I'm 53 now, so I was like a different person, but there's a naivety about it that's appealing that I hope has been replaced by some kind of wisdom.
Yeah, well, I want to go back out to tonight in a minute, because obviously you're going to sing it at the end. I just want to go back on the history of. But just staying with the type of music that you're writing these days, I mean, is there a kind of a fresh honesty, do you think, about what you write when you're older?
I think there is, because we are writing about our own experiences. It's a bit like, Pilgrim's Progress, sitting down, telling each other stories of what's happened to us over the last 5 years. And that's the way you can be really honest with yourself. And I think that's what we've managed to do with the album.
I think songwriters are so lucky, because you can go into that fantasy world, can't you, and write about all those fantasies in your mind.
It's a world of imagination that's wonderful, yeah. It's like opening a little door into a private room that's got all of your sort of magical things in it. Lovely.
And you don't have to tell the wife about it either, do you?
Well, it's hard to share with her, yeah.
So you just listen to the songs and know what's going on in there.
Yeah. Mind you, they're usually our biggest critics.
Definitely.
Our best critics.
Yeah, best.
Let's have a look at some original footage, I'll put it like that. But you'll enjoy this. As they say, every foot a Rembrandt. Don't you think that you get to a stage in your life, you look back at a film like that, and you think it's brilliant?
Well, I'm glad that it's there. Like a lot of the old footage, I'm glad that it's there as a record of the time. And
did you like his hair long?
Yes, right now, isn't it?
Yeah.
Actually, yours looks rather full at the moment.
Oh, yeah.
Vitamins.
Vitamins.
Growing strong. It looks good. On this whole aspect of touring, because although you had a break for 4 or 5 years, nevertheless, you've managed to stay together. Now, what do you think is the secret ingredient, then, of keeping a band together for that length of time?
Music, to begin with. Yeah. You have to have the music, and we got together to really write our own songs. And then friendship. We've become really good friends over the years. But I think the most important thing is we are all independent people, and we have our own sort of world we live in. And that gives an enormous freedom between all of us. So when we come back as the Moody Blues, it's
fantastic. A valid point, because you've all had your solo careers and done extremely well in the solo angle. So I suppose you can then come together with a greater confidence as a band.
Yeah, you can, and you bring things to the band, and each one, you know, because we have very different lives, and that we bring different things to the band, you know, really. There's a lot of reasons people love the music, and people love the old songs as well, and that's a wonderful thing to be able to share.
Do you like the wives to go on tour with you?
Yes, of course.
You fibber, you do not. Does it not work, wives going on tour?
You know, it's not that it doesn't work, it's that if on tour, if you haven't got a job to do, it's the most boring thing. Mm, yeah. Because then you're like just like a piece of baggage, and you just have to, what time are we leaving? You know, but if you've got a job to do, then it's great. But if you've got nothing to do, then don't bother, really.
So a lot of phone calls and a lot of letters home.
Yes. Yeah, except, of course, if it's Los Angeles or New York.
Yeah, somewhere. Then,
shopping, yes. Shopping.
Yes, of course, yes.
Of course, fantastic.
And they can come shopping with us, too. Yes.
Now, I was in America not that long ago, and I know that the Moody Blues are just hugely popular over there. And you also made it onto The Simpsons. Now, this is really like street cred beyond belief. How did that happen?
Well, actually, the Simpsons creator really decided that Homer was a Moody Blues fan, and he just called us and asked us if we were into that as well, and we said yeah, of course. So I hope I'm not talking out of turn here, but I think they believe that probably now that Homer is maybe a more interesting character than Bart, or it's just for a different sort of audience, and so they wrote us into an episode where we appeared in it.
Guess what? I have it.
Oh, okay.
Here it is.
Somebody help! Our husbands are trying to ditch us!
Someone dishonoring their marriage vows? Not in Las Vegas. Attention all employees. We've got two runaways. Stop them.
Oh, no.
A lion!
Frederick Tatum!
Your behavior is unconscionable.
The Moody Blues!
Cold-hearted Homer ditching his wife, while ancient Ned runs for his life.
Chips of red and blue and white, but we decide we
can the poems, it's arse-whooping time. I want fatty.
I love it, I love it. I tell you what, that gives you a lot of brownie points for your kids.
Lots.
Absolutely.
Now listen, I know we said about the history, we've only got a few seconds just before the break, but can you just very quickly tell me the history of Nights, because we want to hear it at the end.
It was part of a stage show that we were writing to do on stage, and Mike, our original keyboard player, wrote a lovely song called Dawn Is a Feeling. And so I just sat on the side of the bed one night, and a girl had actually given me some white satin sheets. Terribly inconvenient if you've got a heavy beard. I was in the end of one love affair, beginning of another one, and just sat down and wrote it, and the song came out.
But happily, 30 years later, you're still with the other one.
Yes, that's true.
In this case. Yeah. We're really looking forward to hearing the song. Good luck on the tour and with the new album. Thank you both very much for joining
us. Thank you.
Good
luck.
You have to stay with us on the program, because as I mentioned, the Moody Blues will be playing that classic Nights in White Satin live right here in the house right at the end of the program. Now after the break, Stefan Buchatsky will be taking the potluck out of repotting your plants, and then actress Carol Drinkwater discusses her latest book. So we'll see you right after the break. That was lovely.